Good morning. Welcome to Bazaar Morning Call. I'm Latha and with me is Anuj. We are missing Sonia, but we are nevertheless cheered up. Sonia actually cheers us up a goodish bit. We are cheered up because we are heading to a long weekend. We are cheered up because the Bulls at long last have a bit of a tailwind. Yesterday was an unexpected huge bounce, and I think the market is coming to terms with the fact that the government is coming to terms with the slowdown. But before that, just a word on the global situation. The risk appetite looks strong, both on Wall Street and in Asia. And for us, this is combined with crude still lingering around $57. So it's a great combo for us in terms of a global backdrop. Not that we've always been able to take advantage, but today we look like we are in a mood to take advantage. To come back to the slowdown issue, until now the fear was that nothing much is coming as a package from the government to attend to it. But yesterday, the series of meetings, the sheer visual effect of so many leaders, business leaders going and meeting the government indicated the seriousness. The sound bites that we got, we will play them out to you again. Sajan Jindal, Ajay Piramal, TV Narendran, we'll play out those bites that clearly indicated the seriousness of government to get around the slowdown issue. Today, the government is going to be meeting market men on the same issue, and the expectation, of course, is that the FPI issue could get redressed in some fashion. We've been reporting for some time now that that is under discussion. All that has come to a head, and it's coming at a time when the FII selling from, you know, 3,000, 2,000 crore rupees has come down to 300, 400 crore rupees, 1/10. So my sense is the bounce has some legs to run. Anuj, you take?
Morning, Latha. Two or three points I want to make here. For starters, is NSE accountable? The data is not getting updated again.
At the right time. Yeah.
And, you know, yes, forget right time till now. And, you know, yesterday was such a big rally. I want to see how much of this rally was pure short covering, how much of this rally was buying. Open interest data has not been updated yet. You know, for me, this is a very important part of the market internals. It tells me a lot about the big buyer or the
nature
big seller. The nature of buying and selling. You know, remember we were discussing 2 days back, FII long exposure was almost back to historic lows, and from there you normally expect a short covering bounce, which is what happened. But, you know, tough for me to say right now. And you know what? There are some institutions, but, you know, I haven't seen anyone who's so, I mean, NSE, they just don't care and they won't reply. And they, you know, it's just absolutely ridiculous the way, you know, NSE takes things for granted. And, you know, as if they are, you know, alone to themselves, and absolutely no accountability, absolutely zero accountability. And I don't know, I mean, someone should be taking them to task. But having said that, manufacturer rallies sell off. And yesterday was a manufacturer rally. And it's funny that, you know, sometimes these reports come out on a Thursday, which is the weekly options expiry. And you know what? This is a long weekend. Also, this is going to be a 3-day expiry now. Because, you know, 15th is holiday. So, 14th, the expiry shifts to 14th. So, you have today, then you have Tuesday, and Wednesday is the expiry.
Exactly.
So, okay. You know, it's like a bit of a 2020 game which is on right now. But anyway, can the rally extend to 200-day moving average? I think it's possible. The 200-day moving average on the Bank Nifty is 28,400. On the Nifty, it's 11,160. So, perhaps we make a dash towards that. This is a sucker's rally, or is likely to be a sucker's rally, you know, unless proven wrong. But this point that FII selling has come down, the intensity, second day running, and yesterday was a good day for them to sell because stock prices were higher. So that way, yesterday, I think, was quite interesting. And there was some big buying in Reliance and HDFC Bank. The only problem was that this was essentially a short covering move because the mid caps didn't move much. Advanced decline was not terribly great. Mid cap index underperformed. And you know what? Unless all these meetings translate into some kind of action, this is exactly the kind of rally that gets sold into. And all the rallies from here on will be vulnerable to be sold into. Also because I just feel that, you know, the Nifty had that unfinished business at 10,600. And normally when, you know, market corrections bounce back from, you know, without completing the unfinished business, you normally see a second round of selling. So, you still have to play the short covering. But don't overstay your welcome. At the first sign of reversal, I think should get out, because this is clearly still a bit of a bear market in which we're having a bit of a short covering bounce.
I think you're the master of the markets, and I take your word on, you know, this unfinished business at 10,600. But what you said is spot on, that unless the meetings result in something concrete, the market, this is a sucker's rally.
Yeah.
Now, let's be very clear, how much can they offer? I mean, you can't start flying kites saying LTCG will be cut and dividend tax and buyback. I mean, this is a government that is seriously falling short on taxes. Last year, tax revenue growth was 6%, way below the expected 19.9. Yeah. See, 19.9 was always kite flying.
Yeah.
What do you normally get? Nominal growth of the GDP plus 1 or 2 percentage points for tax buoyancy. So 14% tax growth is about the best we can expect. Last year we did 6%.
Yeah.
There is no growth.
Yeah.
Profit announcements this quarter have been abysmal. The government can't be in a giveaway mood, especially when they've undertaken a major responsibility of transferring 2,000 rupees to families, you know, about 6 crore families, farmer families, every quarter. There is a responsibility. That money has to be provided for. They can't keep on cancelling all the taxes. This is like some nonsense that's going on in terms of expectation.
Kite flying is okay, but you know.
Yeah, I know, this is real money.
Prices actually, like that, you know. Yeah.
What we should remember is that this is a real slowdown. Certain things can be fixed. The auto sector, for instance.
Yeah.
If a sectoral, you know, ticking of boxes, allowing early scrappage of vehicles, something sensible is done about the auto sector, that will result in some bit of the arresting of the slowdown. So the government can do a lot of things, but we should not run away with the idea that we are all going to get to 25% corporate tax or, you know, dividend tax goes out. These things are not possible for the government at its current circumstance. Maybe when growth picks up, it's a different issue. So, you know, that's why I think, Anuj, your words are very important, that till you see the action, or if you see a reversal in the markets, people who are taking, playing intraday games, better watch out. There is a genuine slowdown. The backdrop, global backdrop, is a very difficult backdrop. Even today, the yuan is a little weaker. You know, the fixing has come at 7.01. So the trade war has not gone away. The currency war has not gone away. Global slowdown has not gone away. India may be in a new normal. There are brokerages which have called the GDP at 6.4%. All this is not going away in a hurry. The 9-10 month long auto contraction is not getting over in July. I mean, hopefully August will be different, will be a little better as the base also gets a little favorable. But let's not underestimate the slowdown. And also, let's wait for concrete steps from the government. Let us remember yesterday, Jonathan Schiesel telling us that the FII tax is an annoyance.
It is an annoyance. It's not the reason for the market to fall. The market fall is because of what's happened to the economy. Also, just one more point. The market yesterday was extremely oversold. It was at sitting duck for something like this to move up the market. Now, you know, I'm not casting any aspersions here, but, you know, from 230, the kind of move that you had in the market, and if you see the options data, and if you see the kind of calls, you know, which were bought, and the kind of surge in premiums, you know, I'll just leave it there. But, you know, there's the, you know, like Schiesel also said, just because there was a stack, I mean, it's not as if our market was a big outperformer even before that issue was there. But anyway, let's leave it there.
So important to note that there are economic problems. We are waiting for solid economic solutions. And people who are playing intraday positions on the basis of this news should not forget that this is a government that's hamstrung for finances. And therefore, we must not run away with expectations of giveaways. With that backdrop, let's get to some solid economic advice or equity advice. What our experts have to say this morning before we start trading. Our expert today is Harold Vanderlind of HSBC. Harold says, after the latest sell-off, we revisit our preferred valuation methodology to assess whether Asian equities are fairly valued. He highlights the Philippines, China and India as now offering the most potential value, and Malaysia, Taiwan and the least India appears as the third most undervalued market in their model, while he remains neutral at the regional level.
Okay, let's get you some money market views then. Bhaskar Panda of HDFC Bank says the Indian political climate settling down will help the rupee today. He expects the USD-INR pair to trade in a range between 70.45 to 70 for today, so expecting some strength.
Okay, and on bonds, Bhaskar Panda says they are settling down to ranges. He expects the 10-year benchmark bond yield to trade within the range of 6.35 to 6.4043.
Okay, let's talk about the global cues. Here's Mangalam with the world view.
Well, there was a rally on Wall Street yesterday. In the previous trading session, the Dow recovered 600 points from the lows. So you add yesterday's gain to it, it's a near 1,000-point rally from the lows in the last couple of trading sessions. And that's primarily because there has been some risk on, or fears of risk have been abated. And that's what's reflected in the sort of moves that we saw in the U.S. bond yields as well, which they came off the lows. The German bond, for instance, was close to around 0.6 negative. That has strengthened to about 0.56 or thereabouts. As a result of which the European markets did fairly well as well. The state of the world is definitely explained in two results. Sportswear, fitness wear maker Adidas results disappointed the street. Stock ended lower by around 2%, whereas Danish beer company Carlsberg, they are upbeat on volume expectations going ahead, and that stock surged by around 11%. We have more data coming in from Asia, though, today. The Japanese GDP surprised positively, as a result of which that added a further boost to the rally that we saw in the Wall Street and the Asian markets as well. The Chinese People's Bank of China has set the yuan midpoint higher by above 7 for the second day in a row. So that's something we'll watch out for as well. The Asian screen looks very bright and green, though off highs. And as a result of which, the SGX Nifty also is mildly off highs, indicates a flattish start to trade.
Okay, that's as good as it gets. Mangalam, for the last few days, you've been telling us that the SGX Nifty is starting in the red. So we will take that with both hands. Thank you very much. And now for the big cue that kept the markets going yesterday, the finance minister met top industrialists to discuss steps to boost slowing growth and get their outlook on the current economic situation. Top corporate leaders, including Dilip Sanghvi, Sajjan Jindal, Sanjeev Puri, T.V. Narendran, Ajay Piramal and many others attended this meeting. We could ambush some of them on their way out. Here are the key takeaways.
The minister has very categorically mentioned that the banks would be, there would be a process to see that this, the cut which the RBI has announced, which is about 110 basis points,
right,
and only about 30 basis points about has been passed on to the industry.
The recent proposal in the Companies Act to basically penalize companies if they do not fulfill their CSR norms. That was one issue which the industry has been talking.
So on that matter, it was discussed that the jail term or something like that, that punitive action will not be taken.
That will not be taken. That was the assurance that
was given? The assurance given, yes.
It was a very positive interaction, and the FMS said that she would be looking at the issues very quickly and to address them. And the issues were wide-ranging across the issues are across various sectors.
Your sector,
right from how to make, say, food processing competitive and attractive, how to make agriculture competitive so that it can get its due share in the global value chains.
What needs to be done is more transmission to the ground. I think SBI has announced some changes. I think they've announced 10 or 15, but effectively, if you look at it, the RBI has cut about 110, and what has been transmitted is about 20 or 25. So I think we need to see more of that. There were lots of suggestions. I think it would be unfair to talk very specific, but liquidity was one issue discussed. Accelerating the infrastructure spend, which was announced in the budget, was discussed. Funds to the MSME sector and other parts of the economy were discussed. So there were many, many suggestions. So like I said, it was more a long list of suggestions from multiple parts of the industry.
Generally, a lot of things were spoken about, no specific stimulus.
Sorry, on CSR, what is it that industry has said and what assurance
has So CSR, people said that we do want, that there was a question raised that do you want to have this limit of CSR? The industry said, yeah, we should have it. Industry was only saying that let's not have any provision which is penal like jails and all so on.
Okay, now let's move on. We understand that the finance minister will today meet market participants, including FIIs and FPIs. Ahead of that meeting, Nandita Parker, managing partner at Karma Capital Management, is with us. Nandita, hi, good morning. Thanks a lot for joining us. You know, yesterday we had one of the big FIIs, Jonathan Schiesel, telling us that the FII taxation is an annoyance and not the reason for the market fall or the FII selling. Your thoughts on the same, and what's your expectation?
Yeah. So, Anuj, I completely disagree with that thought. I think that the FII selling of the past month, the $2 billion, is directly attributable to what was passed in the budget on July 5th. I also want to go back a little bit in history and tell you that in February 2018, when the long-term capital gains tax was passed in the previous budget, that year in 2018, FII net outflows of from India were almost $5 billion. And at that time, there was no big shock of economic slowdown or anything like that. If you go back in history a little bit more, and bear with me for a minute, the period of 2004 to 2016 were the golden years of FPI flows. And these also coincided with in a time when majority of the FPIs were coming through the Mauritius route. And in effect, they were not paying long-term or short-term capital gains taxes in India. They were paying these taxes in their home countries. Now, this is the global norm that FPIs and foreign residents pay capital gains tax in their country of residence. And India is today, since last year, standing out on the global stage as one of the few nations, the other two being Bangladesh and Pakistan, a club I don't think we really want to be to belong to, that are taxing foreign portfolio investors both on capital gains and as well as STT. Now, let me tell you the impact of this, of taxing foreign portfolio managers and foreign residents, is that you are not only cutting into their returns by a significant amount, because you know you've got your long-term capital gains and your short-term capital gains, and now you've got a surcharge on top of that. So your average, amount that you're eating into returns is 22-23%, something like that. And what's even worse is when you look at pension funds, when you look at endowments, especially in the U.S., they are tax-free. And so there is no way that they will invest in India in this kind of an environment in large amounts. If you think about how much FPI flows India should actually be receiving on an annual basis, I've got an estimate that shows that India can get something like 25 to 35 billion in annual FPI flows. This year's number year to date is 8 billion. Okay, so we're clearly underperforming. And I think it's time that the policymakers step back, look at the picture more holistically, say, okay, what is it that's keeping these flows out of India? Why are global emerging market, global mutual funds underweight India? Okay. In fact, if you go back to very recent history, even in December of 2014, global emerging market funds will overweight India by 550 basis points. So here's a number. If you go back to that kind of an overweight position, if you then add about $10 billion that would come in just by global mutual funds going to an equal weight on India, you're getting to $35 billion. Now, in an economy where the Prime Minister Modi has come in and said he wants India to grow from the current GDP to trillion to $5 trillion in 5 years, this is one important piece that needs to be addressed by policymakers, by Madam Nirmala Sitharaman. And I'm very, very hopeful that today's meeting will bring us to some kind of an understanding that a whole lot more needs to be done other than the surcharge, that we really need to think a little bit more forward. We need to understand the importance of equity markets for the economy. And when you say that they're not, you know, that the surcharge and the taxation is just an irk or a small point, I I really disagree. I think that these equity markets are a barometer of the economy, and they're telling you something. They're telling you that FPIs are unhappy with the current situation, that they're not going to allocate unless some major measures are brought in. On the taxation front, India has been standing as an outlier on the global stage, and it's time for us to set our house in order.
Yeah, Nadira, we have to just move on. I want to know what your views are about the slowdown that we are seeing, you know, in automobiles, in several other sectors, and of course, the real estate NBFC issue as well. That has kept this FIIs in sell mode even before the budget.
Okay, so actually, Latha, this repercussions of ILFS started last August, September, and so on. And if you think of it from a time frame standpoint, we've had almost a whole year of a slowdown and the impact of the NBFC liquidity shortfall. I think we are not in the early part, but we're more towards the latter part of a correction of this situation. And given that the new government has come in, has taken charge, given the steps that they've taken, even in the last week, in terms of having consultations with industry, I think that some things are going to begin to move. Probably in the near to medium term, we have had a very good monetary policy meeting in the past week, and I think there is time to look a little bit more constructively, because you must, and I know you will agree with me, that the mood on Dalal Street has been full-on bearish, and I think the pendulum has swung very much to an extreme here, and it's time to think a little bit more constructively. I also want to make one more point here, which is reflexivity. If this equity market corrects itself, and what I mean is, look at the wealth that has eroded since February 2018 to today. $350 billion of wealth has been eroded. That has had a negative impact on spending and on the economy. And that's something we really don't talk about. We just kind of, you know, just sort of a number that somebody will have at the back of their minds. Imagine if this corrects, okay? Don't you think that'll have a positive impact on the economy, on demand, and so on?
Okay, now that point is taken. Nandita, of course, you know, there's some meetings with the industry as well. On autos in particular, which is the sector which has seen the worst times over the last 4 or 5 months, what do you think, you know, should be done to sort of revive the sector?
So I'm sure that the auto majors have already asked for a number of subsidies and so on. I think there's a lot of factors that have come together, along with the BS6 norms, the EV policy, the NBFC liquidity shortfall, and then you've got Ola and Uber. You know, a lot of people are just not buying another car, and you've got the cost of registrations, the cost of insurance. So, you know, 6 or 7 factors have come in.
Yep.
And I'm sure that the government will do whatever it can, whatever is in their power at this point, to at least, you know, correct some of the missteps that have been announced.
So your take is that if the FPIs get a carve out from the tax surcharge, we could see a reversal, and FII inflows could come quickly into India.
I think that a reversal in the short term is definitely warranted. I also think that the issue of long-term capital gains tax and taxation of FPIs must be taken head-on right away. I don't think it should be, we should wait for that to happen.
Okay. All right. Let's see what comes out of the meeting. Thank you very much, Nandita Parker, for joining us and giving us the market perspective on what is expected from the government. We have to take a break. And after that, we're going to get completely micro our top 10 list of stocks that we will be watching out for.